Welcome to the National Indoor Arena in Birmingham, where an expectant and very noisy crowd are on hand to witness the BBL Cup final between the Scottish Rocks and the Sheffield Sharks. This is basketball's equivalent of the FA Cup, the grandest spectacle in a domestic basketball calendar. And for those of you who haven't seen the British game before, well, here's a taste of what you can expect. Pump it up, you came to get it drunk with a dame, and shit it drunk, you came to get it on. More than 5 O's in your bank to get it on. Roll up like that thing can get it on. Plank to fit it on, came to get it on. Hold up, you wanna work that, twerk that. Let me in, let me hurt that, murk that. Say you gotta hurt back. Can't spit it out, boo, you gotta slurp that. Can't cut a rap that we doing, it wasn't worth that. Joey, I'm responsible for bringing dirt back. Can we back up? She has the bar style and she throwing it up. She drank a little Hypno, throwing it up. But I'm only dealing with freaks that wanna cut mine. If you agree and one nut, can't try to get it played late night on BT Uncut. Fellas, do your thing, let me do my thing. I mean, do your thing, let me do my thing. Move that thing, let me move that thing. Come on, move that thing, let me move that thing. Hustle, do your thing, let me do my thing. Pinpoint passing, rim rocking, sharp shooting action, courtesy of some of the best players in the British game, contesting this, the BBL Cup final, the first piece of silverware to be contested in the 2003-2004 season. Joining us this afternoon to discuss the events of the joining us to discuss the events of the afternoon, Billy Mims, former BBL Coach of the Year, a man who's won everything there is to win in the British game, except this trophy, Billy, because even though it is the only straight knockout competition in the BBL, it's actually, the structure of it has changed just a little bit. Explain those changes, if you would.
Well, like you say, when you compare it to the FA Cup, it is the FA Cup of British basketball. And we used to have the format where teams from the lower divisions also competed in the early rounds against BBL squads. This year, it was a knockout competition between BBL clubs only. So night in and night out, professional basketball at its best.
So in a nutshell then, you can conceivably reach the final by playing less games with the absence of the lower league clubs, but all of those games are playing against top flight, fellow top flight competitors. So what's your evaluation of the changes that have taken place?
Well, it puts a bit more pressure on the players and coaches because the preparation is that you're playing another professional side and every round is going to be a bit tougher. You lose out on that sort of emotional bit where you had the small fish from the lower division, maybe hosting a big fish in the first round, early stages of the competition. You don't have that, but you got professional basketball at the highest level, every stage. And today is the final stage of that battle.
Indeed it is. Well, let's meet the two teams that are contesting it. It's the Scottish Rocks and the Sheffield Sharks.
Pete Scantlebury, head coach for the Westfield Sharks Sheffield. My team plays hard, up-tempo basketball, but most importantly, we play together. I've been going for a minute, now I'm back with the jump off.
Goons in the club, case something jumps off. Get back up for the high, the pump off. Lenar Stewart, 6'7", rebounder, shot blocker, and explosive around the basket. We the best, still is room for like a black
Robert Yanders, 5'11", I'm a playmaker, and my pass is fine, the open guy for open basket.
Ian McKinney, 6'1", team captain and three-point specialist coming off the bench.
Justin Phoenix, 6'8", and I score 16 points from around here.
Nate Rankin, 6'2", I score 16 points a game from out here. We're the team's top scorer.
H.L. Coleman, 6'7", live wire, high energy, giving opponents nightmares on both ends of the court. Come through, blow the spot. Come on, yeah. Hey, yo, she back at it. Why wouldn't she miss?
When I move, you move. Just like that. When I move, you move. Just like that. Hell yeah.
I'm Steve Swanson, coach of the Scottish Rocks. I've got an exciting team. They play with heart and intensity and will always fight to the very end.
Stand up! Stand up! Stand up! Stand up!
David Cruz, 6'8", sharpshooter from anywhere on the court.
CEO, you don't have the CID. I'm young, wild, and strapped like G.I. Lee. Blah!
Philip Perry, 6'6", bringing hustle and energy on both ends of the court.
Keith Bunyan, 6'3", one of the best three-point shooters in the league.
Over, over, Luda got something to say. Do it now, cause tomorrow ain't promised a day.
Terrence McGee, 6', whether feeding my teammates or hitting an open shot, I'm a double threat. You can't guard me.
I'm Jerry Williams, 6'6". I'm putting up 23 points, 8 rebounds a game. I'm the franchise.
Stand up! Stand up!
Both teams in their navy blue strips, their home strips during that preview. But for this final, Sheffield have been designated as the away team, and so will be in their chain strip of yellow. And Billy, let's discuss the Sheffield squad first of all. They were formed in the 94-95 season, so they've been around for 9 years now. And in an incredible 7 out of those 9 years, they've won a trophy of some description or another. Remarkably consistent. But what are the key characteristics to this edition of the Sheffield Sharks?
Well, the key characteristic of the Sheffield Sharks is organization. Whether they've had a different coach, different years, different players, they continue to win. They won with Jim Brandon as coach. They won with Chris Finch as coach. They're back here in a cup final with Pete Scantlebury as coach. They've had different players, but they continue to win. Organization is the key to this Sheffield Sharks team.
Okay, well, as you can probably see behind us, the players are warming up. In the midst of their warm-up, the adrenaline pumping in anticipation of the start of this BBL Cup final. But let's head to the relative calm and isolation of the locker room, where just a few moments ago, head coach Peter Scantlebury was with his team.
All right, things they do. They want a break. So transition D is important for us so we get behind the ball, especially Williams and Perry. Both of them like to get their head down and get in the middle of the paint. All right, so we got to get back so they see numbers and they pull it out. All right, they will go to the offensive boards. Playing on these rims, like yesterday in practice, you know there's going to be some long rims, long rebounds. So Nate, Rob, Ian, all the guards, get the box out, get your man, maybe we can get out.
Well, those are scenes from the Sheffield locker room just a few moments ago. Their opponents today are the BBL's representatives from north of the border, the Scottish Rocks. They were formed in 1998. They were based in Glasgow since last season. They've been based in Edinburgh. There's the team graphic for you now. And Billy, what are the strengths of this Scottish Rocks team?
Well, the Scottish Rocks are young in professional basketball terms. They're a young organization, but they've got talent and they know how to win. They're coming into today's cup final as last year's BBL championship winners, so they do know how to win. One of the problems today, though, injuries. Nicky Arinze, one of their best players, not going to be involved in the game today. That's going to be a big loss. But a key factor for them is Jerry Williams. Jerry last season played for his opponent today, the Sheffield Sharks. And I'm sure Jerry Williams will have a big point to prove today to his old side.
Jerry Williams, as you can see, part of that Scotland starting five there. And as in reaching this final, they've had overtime wins at a quarterfinal and semi-final stages, illustrating the point that Coach Steve Swanson made, that they fight to the end. How important is that quality going to be in the final today?
Today, forget the injuries, forget all the excuses. This is one basketball game, 40 minutes of great action, and somebody's going to walk off the court a champion. Today, those overtime victories, Steve Swanson's trying to convince his team, we are the team of destiny, and our destiny is to win the BBL Cup.
Well, let's look at the head-to-head statistics between the two teams. They've met 23 times overall. Scotland with down by 17-6. Sheffield leading that matchup 17-6. But in the last 10 games, the balance of power has shifted, with Rocks winning 7 out of the last 10 matchups. And in the two times they've met this season, Billy, they've shared one game apiece. So where does the advantage lie?
Well, the Scottish Rocks, as you said, Ron, have beaten the Sheffield Sharks this year. But that one win came with Nicky Arinze on court. That is a big loss to Steve Swanson today. I feel that the experience, the talent, and the depth of the Sheffield Sharks will carry them through this match today.
Okay, Billy, we'll hear more from you throughout the course of the afternoon as you'll be providing colour and analysis alongside our main commentator, Bob Ballard.
Thank you, Ron. And let's get you through some of the important rules that will occur during the course of the afternoon. There is the three-point arc, that big black semicircle where the 3 points will come from. And that's obviously what a lot of the key players like Ian McKinney and Nate Reinking for Sheffield will be looking for. 4 quarters of 10 minutes each. When the ball is in play, the clock will start. It's a stopping clock every time the ball goes out of play. Rolling substitutions where there's a break in play, they can bring in new players. And 5 individual fouls, very key. If you get 5 fouls, you're out. If you get 5 fouls per team in one of the quarters, then you start picking up free throws. We'll tell you more about that as the game continues.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, a very so it's the talent and tenacity of the Scottish Rocks against the teamwork of the Sheffield Sharks in this afternoon's BBL Cup final. Here are the player introductions.
Protagonists, the ones that the respective coaches in the shape of Steve Swanson for the Scottish Rocks and Peter Scantlebury for the Sharks has decided are going to start this off. Not always necessarily the best players on the court, but there are rules and regulations and reasons why some people come into the game a little later on. You've heard about Ian McKinney. He's certainly a key player to watch wearing number 5 of the Sheffield Sharks, but doesn't start this one. Sheffield Sharks with a great pedigree in all of their knockout competitions. As Ron said, they've won a lot more than they've lost, and they have first possession. They're playing from left to right. As we look, Nate Reinking with the Anders. Should be good distribution. Peter Scantlebury's always said, with a game like this, the game will be won inside, probably rather than outside. H.L. Collins had the flu, but no problems early on for him. Nate Reinking goes for the long bucket, but it doesn't fall, and the first foul of the game is committed by Gordon of the Scottish Rocks. And here's Billy.
And Ronnie Gordon there, we talked, Bob, about their overtime victory in the semifinal. They wouldn't be here today without this 6'10" Scotsman. The Braveheart hit one an amazing three-pointer with no time left on the clock at Crystal Palace to send the semifinal into overtime, which the Scottish Rocks ultimately won.
4 quarters of 10 minutes, 24 seconds they're allowed to take the shot. One shot was taken in that opening 20, so no problems for the Sharks. They have a reset on the shot as the ball comes inbounds from Yanders. Looking for Mia Phoenix outside, backing into the basket, looking for a way forward. It's the last two, the last two of the game, falls away for the Sheffield Sharks.
Bernard Stewart is so good around the basket, and that's going to be an area of concern for Coach Steve Swanson. You cannot let Bernard Stewart get the ball that close. He won't miss that close to the bucket.
Man on the ball just now. Terrence McGee had a little bit of an injury, but he is starting as the first player of the game. Jerry Williams, player of the month for October, shows why he got that accreditation.
Well, he's the captain of the Scottish Rocks, the player of the month, and he's also the one guy that played for these Sheffield Sharks last year. Now, I know he's got a lot to prove today to his former club.
Well, would it be a case of coming back to your old team and putting one over on them? They're going from outside now, Sheffield as well. The rebound falls away. Oh, the Sheffield Sharks. Well, I thought the last touch came off Sheffield. So did the Scottish Rocks in the shape of Jerry Williams, but it's end-line possession. Baseline possession once again for the Sharks with Yanders. It's a very strong first five, this, for the Sheffield Sharks. Xander's going inside and pulling back outside. They're trying to work their way carefully to the basket. Lots of bodies under there. Good defense by the Scottish Rocks under the hoop to stop them making any further progress. Here's Williams. There are two Williams in the Scottish Rocks teams. There's Jerry Williams and Junior Williams, who wears number 10. We'll be seeing a lot more of number 8 than number 10, I think.
I think so. Junior Williams has had a bit of an injury this season. He's only just now getting the fitness from the medical advisors to play. So, again, Jerry Williams probably will see a lot more time.
Foul on the hoop. 2 points and one. For the Sheffield Sharks here. They get the two from the shot, one from the free throw line, and they take the lead.
Bob, you're looking at contrasting styles of play so far. The Scottish Rocks have scored on a three-point field goal, and they had a turnover in running transition basketball. Sheffield have brought the ball up and been playing half-court basketball, slowing it down right around the basket, and everything for Sheffield so far has been going to the basket. Two inside buckets by Leonard Stewart, and now you see Justin Feeney's going to the free throw line, fouled while inside as well.
Justin Feeney with the extra point, and Ron McIntosh has some news for us.
Well, you can see that Sheffield now on 5 points, but both of their field goals have come from the inside. That's the area close to the basket. And that's the area that Scottish coach Steve Swanson was concerned about. Nicky Rinze is his best player, his best inside presence. He would deter a lot of those shots. Of course, he's not around today, and Scotland have got to try and find a way to stop Sheffield scoring inside.
Jerry Williams looking for the breakaway initially, but joined by the cavalry. McKee from outside for three. Back off the hoop it comes. Rebound for Cruz. Cruz and then set it up again. Another 24-second shot clock. Williams finds Martin, the new man in the team. Has been playing in northwest London, but drafted in because of the Arinze injury. Rankin goes baseline. No room for him to move. Good work again by the Rocks under the hoop, and that could be a very key area for them.
No question about it. You can see Peter Scantlebury, he's a rookie coach, his first year as a coach, a very close friend of mine for a long time, great England international player, but Pete is concentrating so far. Here we go again, ball going inside.
Again, they're trying to go baseline, but no room is given to them, no quarter given to them by the Scottish Rocks, and back for the edge again.
Say inside, then they kick it out to H.L. Coleman, and he buries the first three of the game for the Sheffield Sharks.
8-5. Sharks are going to play an inside game by the looks of things, unless they have to change it. They're good enough to do that. Williams goes all the way, and we'll get the bonus as well. 2 points and one to come as he gets fouled on his way to the hoop.
Well, Jerry Williams is the leading scorer of the Scottish Rocks, and with Nicky Arinze not by... Normally, Williams and Arinze both contribute over 20 points a game. Now, here's a great replay. Great at camera angle here by BBC Cameras, and what a move. You see him coming right to the camera, attacking the basket. He got... contact on the play by Sheffield, drew the foul but missed the free throw.
Second highest scorer in the league last year, 23 points per game. Jerry Williams has got all seven of the Scottish Rocks points so far. Now let's see if Sheffield have changed tactics. They can foul again. 2 points for Phoenix and one to come. A lot of bonus shots coming up here.
Well, it's aggressive basketball. When you attack the basket, that's when you get fouls. Again, a great replay here as the referee gets out of our way. Richard Stokes, the official, backs up. Justin Phoenix attacks the basket, scores, draws the foul. We call this an and one, because he's going to get the 2 points for the basket and one by the one free throw opportunity.
Phoenix on the free throw line to make it 11-7. That's precisely what he does. All the points so far for the Scottish Rocks from the number 8. Jerry Williams in your vision there.
And indeed, we see Jerry Williams. He scored all 7 points for the Scottish team so far. He averages around 23 a game. He's a Scottish Rocks top scorer, but in the two meetings against Sheffield this season, he's been held to 10 and 11 respectively. So he's going to need to get back on track. Looks like he's doing just that. 7 points already.
3 points from Yanders. Williams again for another three-point attempt. That one just fails to drop, goes off right. And again, a very quick break down the left and then halted by Yanders. Looking for a way inside. Ball is for Coleman. Phoenix. Oh, and a foul again underneath the hoop. Sharks have got it. It's against the Scottish Rocks. Fouls on McGee.
Pete Scantlebury said he was going to attack the basket, and Bob, he is tremendously attacking the basket.
Timeout's been called by the Scottish Rocks as Steve Swanson obviously wants to say something, and he'll say something with 5:40 remaining in the first quarter, and Sheffield leading by 14 points to 7.
14 points for the Sharks, Sheffield 7 to the Rocks.
Got here, down there now, down there a couple things. We're approaching these guys, especially Phoenix, okay? He's got it in the corner, he likes to drive right, okay? Remember, for the bigs especially, we're approaching them as drivers, okay? Drivers first, okay? So when you're out there, and you're hustling like crazy, go get them. About a foot or two earlier, you're gonna spread out your stance, okay? Because they're trying to drive it, okay? Read the ball on it, read the ball. Okay, down here. I want to look at some one down. I don't care which way you go. But remember, work yourself to get open, whether it's Philip or Jerry here, okay, either one. Work to get open, get the defender high, maybe a fake this way. You've got that whole baseline. You can also step up, set the screen, okay? If it doesn't end there, again, it's just an entry into our offense, okay? Got to get back, solid, do solid on offense, crash the boards, get some stops down here on that end, okay?
Steve Swanson, the assistant coach last year, were the winners of the previous competition, the cup that we showed you on grandstand last year. Nick Nurse was the coach then. 14-7 then to the Sheffield Sharks against the Scottish Rocks as we resume. And the Sheffield Sharks will go to the free throw line with Lenard Stewart.
Now, Lenard Stewart's doing a great job attacking the basket so far in this game. And he's at the free throw line because of that. I was about to say, probably the only weakness to Lenard's game is he's not a very good free throw shooter. Normally about a 50 to 60% free throw shooter, but he made that first one nicely, made the second one. So usually when you say that about a player, Bob, they end up making both of them.
I have to tell you also, the Scottish Rocks are in team foul trouble now. They've had their 14 fouls. Every time they foul now, Sheffield will go to the basket for two. And at the other end, still continuing, Jerry Williams still has all the points for the Rocks.
Right now, he is carrying Scotland on his back. And I said if they've got a chance to win, he might have to do that. Normally he gets 23 points a game. Today we might need 40 from him to give them a chance, but so far he looks ready for the job.
Trying to stop the charge underneath the hoop, but no way they're going to stop H.L. Coleman in that kind of form. He may have had the flu in the week, but he looks perfectly okay today. Now, can Williams send anybody else up for baskets? At the moment he's doing all the work. Five players on the court, he's the only one with any points. Martin, they're going to try and work it in a different direction, so the streak is broken. First 2 points of the game coming from somebody other than Jerry Williams.
Terry McGee scoring those 2 points, and he was questionable before the game as well with an injured ankle.
Gap is 7 points, 18-11.
We're looking at Phil Perry there, one of the better young English players in the league. Phil was part of the Scottish Rocks last season, started this season with Nick Nurse down at the Brighton Bears. When Nick released him, Scotland were happy to have him back. He played briefly for me in London before he went to the States, had a good college career in America at the University of North Alabama, but a London lad is doing very well in the BBL now.
Coleman, gonna go for the shot, off balance, and that's showed by where the ball finally ended up, just scraping the bottom of the hoop. Williams, cruise from outside for three. Back again for the rebound. They're doing well on the rebounds at the moment. The Scottish Rocks, and a foul committed on the way to the hoop by Lenard Stewart. That's the second team foul for the Sharks. No worries for them, but it will be a possession for the Scottish Rocks.
You know, with the fouls again, before you shoot free throws, you must commit 14 fouls. On the fifth, you go to the free throw line. So you need four to get into what we call the bonus. The only other way you get to the free throw line is if you fouled in the act of shooting, then you get those two automatically.
Perry to Williams, 9 points personal out of the 11 so far. Here is Perry looking to see if there's a gap. I'm going to go right around the semicircle before he can find Williams. There's Cruz, a little up and under. And Sheffield with the rebound, and Rob Yanders has contributed 3 pointers so far to the game, but lots more off the ball. Richard Wendell, one of the Sheffield-born players, is into the action. is Ryan King, right on the edge of that three-point sector. Phoenix, Wendell, is a big man. He's the Andrew Flintoff of Sheffield Sharks, really. And for Nate Ryan King, who will score much more than just 2 points in this game, I can assure you.
I tell you, over the past 8 years or so, Nate Ryan King's been one of the best guards in the BBL. And here's the other Williams in the game, talked about earlier, Junior Williams, now handling basketball at the point guard spot for the Scottish Rocks.
Williams to Williams. No relation, but they've got a bit of empathy going there. Good block again. Good work by Robbie Anders, who is a two-way player, as he's showing here. Trying to get the ball outside of Ryan King. On the 3.8, he's deadly from this distance, but not that time, but he'll have plenty more opportunities. Maybe one coming up here if Yanders opts to give it to him. Slowing it down. They have 18 seconds on the shot clock. Ryan King in a bit of bustle. Ryan King. Yanders all the way, but doesn't get it this time, and it's thrown away with good Michael effort. Martin getting in the way.
Yeah, I was going to say, Bob, it was a good effort by Michael Martin trying to get the rebound, but he didn't come up with it on the play. And right now, that's still a factor that's hurting the Scottish Rocks. The size and athleticism inside with Justin Phoenix out there right now at 6'8". Lenard Stewart, 6'8". Richard Wendell's like 6'9". They just have a much bigger, more athletic inside game than the Scottish Rocks.
20 points to 11. Ryan King, McKinney for the Sheffield Sharks. Wendell, Phoenix, good distribution here. 19 seconds on the shot clock. Finding a way inside if they can with Lenard Stewart. Well, that's great work by Lenard Stewart. What a fantastic basket for Lenard Stewart. Finger roll at the end as well.
He's improved a lot in his couple of years in the BBL, but again, he is such a deadly basketball player. Oh, here's a steal.
Steal for the Sharks. Here's Ray King for two.
And right now, Bob, Steve Swanson probably needs a timeout, but he's already used the one allocated in the first quarter. So I think right now he's praying for this quarter to end so he can talk to them before the second quarter, regroup his side a little bit.
McKee. McKee back off the rim. They're not dropping at the moment. That one does. Plus one. Two for Perry. He'll get the foul shot to come as well.
Bob, that's vintage Phil Perry that we just saw there. That's vintage Phil Perry, because Phil is probably one of the most active players. He goes to the offensive glass, which means goes to when people on his side miss the shots, Phil Perry goes after the rebound and gets a second shot. That's what we saw Phil do there. Not only did he get the rebound, get the second shot and make the basket, he also drew a foul. He's going to have an and-one opportunity.
11 points the gap. Scottish Rocks on the free throw line with Perry. Puts that one away. Ron's got some news.
Philip Perry, as you say, very, very active on the basketball court, and his opposite number, H.L. Coleman, also a high-energy, live-wire type player getting up and down the floor. They were having a running conversation the last time they were matching up. Lots of talk going back and forth, and that's one of the key matchups that will determine the outcome of this game.
Yeah, there's Sue Wendell, who traveled with it. One too many situations. Explain the travel, Billy.
Yeah, the traveling situation is that you must put the ball on the floor before you pick up your what we call your pivot foot. So you cannot take a step before placing the ball on the floor. It's called dribbling. You must dribble. Now you see he, both feet moved before the ball. That's great. Great replay there by the grandstand BBC cameras there. Good work, camera guys. But again, you must put the ball on the floor before you move either foot or it's a violation. Turnover, Scotland's ball.
Martin. Oof. That's gone well wide. Oh, the Scottish Rocks thought it was a touch on the way. But Dale Aitchison, we haven't mentioned the refs yet. Richard Stokes and Dale Aitchison are the refs. Dale Aitchison with the ball, give it to Richard Wendell right now. 24-14, Stewart. Wendell for three. Nobody for the rebound. They'll let that go to safe territory. 50 seconds remaining then. What is, a very positive start by the Sheffield Sharks.
We really need a basket here on this possession. I think it's an important possession. We're down to 44 seconds in the quarter. Sheffield are 10 up. A basket going into the break between the first and second quarter, you know, would be just what the doctor ordered for Scotland right now, a confidence boost.
Looking for three initially, Cruz, but it goes outside to Perry for three instead. They're just not dropping right now. And that's the last thing they wanted. The interesting thing is, look where the points are coming from. Sharks, Phoenix with 5, Ryan King with 4, Coleman with 5, Stewart with 4. They're spreading it around. 9 points to Jerry Williams and not much else for Scotland.
Well, you got to remember, right now, Sheffield are a more balanced basketball team, and a lot of that has to do with the injuries to the Scottish Rocks. They're a much more balanced team when Mickey Arinze's out there. He could carry, and of course, the absence of Mickey Arinze also helps Sheffield's defensive assignments.
Stewart, just off left, that may well have been the last action for them, but there's a chance for the basket. Now, why that went, I don't know, because the clock still had 3 seconds to run, but they're calling it to a halt at the end of 10 minutes. The clock to our right said a couple of seconds. Steve Swanson isn't happy with that decision, but as far as Peter Scantlebury and his team are concerned, they'll just get on with it. 24-14, but certainly the buzzer went before the clock, so a bit of controversy there. It's a bit like USA, USSR in 72.
I don't think we're going to replay this one three times, though, are we, Bob?
No, I don't think so. To be fair, Steve Swanson, the coach, is actually just talking to the officials again about that, because there were 3 seconds, I think, but maybe it was a discrepancy from the timekeeper's bench. They're the Sharks team. And they should be fairly happy with their first 10 minutes.
They've got to be very pleased with how they've played so far. They've got a 10-point lead after a quarter. They've done everything according to game plan so far. But they've got balanced scoring. They've moved the ball well. They've played good defense.
Shots on three. 1, 2, 3.
We have 1.9 seconds to play.
Right, we have 1.9 seconds to play of that first quarter. So they're obviously going to have to replay the back end of that first quarter.
And they've also got to reset the clocks here. Both of the scoreboards have actually just gone out. So we'll have a bit of a longer timeout as they try to reset the clocks. But Bob, I want to point out to the fans watching today, maybe for the first time, is that every second in the game of basketball is important. The Scottish Rocks, remember, 2 overtime wins. They wouldn't even be here if it weren't for the last second shot. Three-pointer made by Ronnie Gordon. So right now it's Scotland's ball. They've got one shot to get off, and if they score, then they would cut this first quarter lead to 7 as opposed to 10. And in the end of the game, this 1 second could prove vitally crucial.
Okay, clock doesn't start till the player on the court touches it, so there's no start until it touches either a yellow-shirted player or a blue-shirted player. It doesn't matter if the ball's in court. It'll start now as Williams gets it. Here comes the shot before the buzzer. Oh, it was so close to dropping as well. How important, how crucial could that be down the stretch? But the clock problem has been resolved. They got their one opportunity, and
24.
The Sharks go back to their position. Steve Swanson goes back with his Scottish Rocks at the end of the first 10 minutes play, so we can confirm that score remains as it was. Let's have a listen to what Pete Scantlebury has to say.
On the offensive end, when the ball goes in the post, we're just standing and watching, we got to move. All right? Take your time, screen. You've got to have somebody coming to the ball. He can't just leave him on his own. All right?
Great defensive possessions, and then they got the ball back. Okay? All right. Down here, both of you to work on getting the ball out of Rob's hands a little bit down here. Okay? Just make those other guys bring it up. Okay? To start back with Mike, Dave, Jerry, Bill, Terrence, you got to start. Okay? All right. 3 down. Rendell's in the game, and McKinney, they might go zone. Okay? So we'll go straight to through. Okay, then high, overload, any of those, just get it in quick. Remember our goals there are to get down the court quick and get the zone. Okay, start so we have more options. Okay, let's go. Hey, they use a lot of energy there, fellas. They only got 10 points to show for it. Okay, this is our quarter now. Rocks, 1, 2, 3, rocks.
Well, he seems quite calm and composed at the moment. He knows what they have to do, but he's to turn this around. But 10 points is a big, big gap, isn't it?
Well, he's trying to be very positive there, Tim. I thought it was great the way he finished the timeout. It was a lot of Exegonoan. Here's the score again, 24-14, a 10-point lead. And that's what he was pointing out. He said to him positively at the end that they used a lot of energy, Sheffield did, in that first quarter, and all they got to show for it's a 10-point lead. And in basketball, Bob, as you know, 10 points is nothing at this stage.
Now, just in case you wondered what happened there, no tip-off at the beginning of the second and fourth quarters. It's sideline possession for the team that had it last.
Well, we go to an arrow situation now, whereas across the court from where we're sitting, Bob, there's a big red arrow sitting at the center court table. And that arrow means that the next time there's a jump ball situation, instead of tossing the ball up, the ball will go to the Sheffield Sharks because the arrow is pointing their way.
Right, so just to clear that up for you, it's a turnaround possession, really. So it would have been Sheffield's ball at the end of the first. So it goes to the Scottish Rocks at the beginning of the second. And the same will happen at the end of the third, vice versa, etc., etc. I hope you're following me on that one. It's a new rule this year and takes a bit of getting used to, I have to say. Robbie Anders then for the Sheffield Sharks. McKinney, a great outside shooter. So too is Jans when he wants to, but that one's over the top. They keep possession, though. Still on the same shot clock, though, because it didn't touch the ring. Yanders looking for a way through. There's a foul as Phoenix goes on his way. He'll get the 2 points and he'll get the bonus to come from the free throw line, and not quite the start that the Scottish Rocks wanted to the second quarter.
Peter Scantlebury emphasized all week in the media, we're going to have to score inside. We're going to attack the basket. Virtually, except for the 1 3-pointer from H.L. Coleman, their entire game plan has been inside. Steve Swanson, the Scottish Rocks, on the other hand, said, our biggest worry is the inside game. Since Nicky Arinze's out with the torn ACL, Nicky Arinze, a couple of weeks ago, tore his anterior cruciate ligament. And so one of their best players offensively, but also their best inside defender in plain clothes on the Scottish Rocks bench today. And Steve Swanson's nightmare was that absence defensively inside, and it's becoming a bigger nightmare.
Well, the guy that's just checked into the game for the Scottish Rocks is number 4, Ronnie Gordon, 6'10", Scottish international, and he's come off the bench, hopefully to stem the tide of inside scoring. Sheffield just scoring at will close to the basket, but hopefully with his big body and his defensive ability, he can slow down that scoring that Sheffield are doing so freely inside at the moment.
Coleman for 3. H.L. Coleman goes into double figures. He's got 10 points. Sheffield have an 18-point lead.
You see, and Ronald McIntosh talked him into that shot, because we've been talking so much about Sheffield's strength inside. What do? They kick it out and they hit another 3.
Well, everything that virtually could go wrong for the Scottish Rocks is going wrong. They turn the ball over there. They're not getting the shots away. At the moment, the Sharks are on an 8-0 run. Phoenix. McKinney doesn't have to go outside at the moment, but they're looking at all their options. Well, here is McKinney for 3 points. Deadline tick again.
Well, the Scottish Rocks decided to make a defensive adjustment on the last couple of possessions. They've gone from man-to-man marking their opponent to a 2-3 zone defense. But twice against that zone, Sheffield have hit 3 pointers. So that's the danger of Sheffield. If you go one-on-one man-to-man marking, they go inside and take advantage of it. If you pack it inside and have a zone defense guarding the basket, they throw it outside and they've got some deadly 3-point shooters.
Foul against Richard Windle. I should say that Ian McKinney, who you just saw put down that 3 for the Sharks, his first in 3-point shooting last year, an accuracy rate of 44.72%. That's pretty damn good.
Bob, he's been traditionally over his career, I think he told us before the game, he's about 1 percentage point career-wise behind his former coach, Chris Finch. And he takes a lot of pride in that. But he's career-wise been one of England's best 3-point shooters.
There's a big man under the basket, Ronnie Gordon, getting fouled, so he will go to the free throw line for 2 and try and trim this runaway lead now. 21 points, 35-14.
Jerry, you can stay in the game and quit chatting.
Ronnie Gordon, issue 2.
Ronnie Gordon then from the free throw line. And even that's not dropping. The Scottish international, first season with the Rocks after 2 years with the Newcastle Eagles. If you're wondering, yes, he's 6'9", 22 last month from Edinburgh, one of the homegrown players.
Bob, we knew that the Scottish Rocks had a mountain to climb today with the injury of a great player like Nicky Arinze not being able to take part today. But I don't believe anybody thought that Sheffield could be up 20 points this early in the basketball game.
They're a powerful side, and they've got a new coach, Peter Scantlebury, clapping his hands. There's his opposite number. Steve Swanson's got a lot to think about, pacing up and down. Well, Sheffield will be able to use the depth of their bench if it goes on like this. McGee, Nice play for two. Second basket of the game.
Nice basket. I know he's got a bit of an injury to his ankle, but we just haven't seen him try to do an awful lot yet, and he looked like he made that move with relative ease.
Well, Richard Whittle trying to be inventive there. A bit like his Sheffield United team yesterday. Big Blades fan. Major League 3-0, and that was an inspiration for him for today. Timeout's been called by Sheffield.
Scottish Phoenix on the record rocks. 17.
Some of their fans. Dunkin' Bam is a reference to Richard Whittle. It's called Bam Bam, by the way, in case you wondered. The big lad there on your screen, number 20, Richard Whittle, has the nickname Bam Bam.
And Richard Whittle there is one of the most physical players in the British game. 6'9" tall, but a real physical specimen. Hits Bam Bam.
All right. Get another stop. Let's go down. Let's work the wheel. Okay, keep it up, fellas, keep it up.
Let's get it forward.
Defense.
Let's play down here, okay? The reason they're scoring down there is we're not doing stuff and putting any pressure on them offensively, okay? Now, defensively, you're staying with the press, okay? Let's go to 22, okay?
22, dropping back to 2-3, okay? All right.
You guys have to make something happen here defensively, solid. Get the rebound, let's go, and have good shots for us. Okay, you got to step up here offensively, let's go.
Rocks, 1-2-3, rocks.
11-3 then to the Sheffield Sharks in this quarter, 35-17 overall. That's a big, big lead, 18 points. And some of their big players, both in stature and in height, really have to step up here to try and stop this being a runaway success. Sheffield didn't win a cup, didn't win the trophy last year. Very rare for them. They took the title, however.
Bob, in that timeout, Steve Swanson was talking to these guys. They've got to step up offensively. And right now, they're getting, it's harder on them defensively because of their lack of offensive firepower. And there's Jerry Williams stepping up offensively.
Great work by him. He goes to 11 points personal. And the Rocks try and eat into this massive lead. They're trying a few interesting moves. There was a travel violation by H.L. Coleman again. He took that extra step. He doesn't agree with Dale Aitchison, the referee, however.
Well, what we saw there, here's H.L. Coleman, is not too happy with the call. But he did travel. I think H.L.'s actually arguing that he got fouled. You see a lot of contact there between Jerry Williams bumping H.L. Coleman on the way to the basket. But I believe it's a good call by the official.
But it's already been turned around again. And Sheffield have the ball at the other end of the court. And it's, I think that gesture just tells you everything you need to know about the way Scottish Rocks are right now.
And the Scottish Rocks are waiting for Sheffield to bring the ball to the floor. And you can see in the picture there, they again have gone to this 2-3 zone defense. Two defenders up top, three defenders guarding the basket underneath. Trying to make Sheffield pass the ball around a little more and hopefully shoot long-range shots.
Ranking for three. Back off the boards again for Coleman.
Bob, you see, they got what they wanted. Scotland got what they wanted there. Sheffield missed a three-point attempt. But when you make them miss the long-range shot, and you got three guys under the basket, you must come up with a defensive rebound. Sheffield got the rebound and scored easily.
37-19, 18 points is up to again. Long range effort, which falls this time, and Terrence McGee gets his first three of the game, and plenty more of those required.
Again, like I said, the ankle injury didn't look too bad on that, and they've got to get a contribution from him.
Oh, Coleman responds, straight trading threes. Three one end, three the other. Coleman goes to 15 points.
That doesn't do any good for you. They had a big three from Terrence McGee. Then they go right back down the floor and give up a three. That's really disheartening to a defensive effort.
39-22, 5:29 remaining of the second quarter. And I tell you what, the Sheffield Sharks like this competition in all its forms. And they like appearing on Sunday Grandstand too, because they love the telly exposure, but they certainly like it when it makes them lift their game like this. Martin for two. Two points for Michael Martin's first of the game.
There's another London lad there, Bob, and another one of my former players. I've got three
former players.
What
are you talking about?
I've got David Cruz, Michael Martin, and Phil Perry all on Scotland, former players. There's one of my guys, Dave Cruz, getting another rebound.
And the guy who just drained that last jump shot for the Scottish Rocks, Michael Martin, only managed to practice with them this week. He was drafted as emergency cover for the injured Nicky Arinze, and he's only been up in Glasgow for this week only. So how quickly he gels with the team is going to determine whether they can come back into this game.
Michael Martin, England international, playing for North West London until earlier this week. Williams, Jerry Williams. Good pass right across to David Cruz. He's got some work to do and almost did it. They'll get the 2 points anyway. And there'll be one to come, will it? So we have a confirmation of that. Is not going on under the basket? No. It'll be Sheffield possession, but the 2 points will count.
Points being credited to Ronnie Gordon.
Here's the missed shot by David Cruz and a great tap in there by Ronnie Gordon. Fantastic play by the big Scotsman. Whistle was blown, almost maybe an inadvertent, or maybe he was going to call goaltending, but because the basket went in, he counted it.
Well, HL Coleman's been got second time for travel. This time he was on the floor when the whistle blew.
Well, you know, Ronald McIntyre said earlier that HL Coleman's a very active player, and active players usually do travel a lot because they move their feet before they move, put the ball on the floor. Sometimes they move their feet, Bob, a little before they think.
15 points, though, is a good return so far. We're not even at halftime. 4 minutes and 12 still remaining. Two fouls apiece, so neither side in any foul trouble early on. The referee wants to work with Peter Scantlebury about something.
You know, you've got 4 minutes and 13 seconds left, and for the viewers watching, and they see that Scotland are down 15 points here, it's by no means out of the game. But what they got to do is get back in small increments. Steve Swanson right now saying, let's cut it to under 10 at the half. That'd be a major effort by them.
David Cruz again, just back off the hoop. He'll try again, maybe this time with Jerry Williams. Another three-point attempt doesn't drop, and they're just not dropping. This is the problem. They're trying everything they know. They're working very hard, but the end result just isn't there. And every time Sheffield, it seems, go back down the other end, they'll capitalize. Yanders is calling for it. He wants it. He's the open man. He's the spare man. And he may get a chance by going from right side of the court to left. Ryan King have only got to take their time and work it around. They've had their shot. And they've got a reset on the shot clock. 15 seconds remaining on that. Stewart. Again, they're going to go from outside. Works his way, loses a chance for a break here. Maybe some spectacular dunker, maybe from Williams. No, just a little layoff, but 2 points nonetheless. He goes to 13, and that's almost half the Rocks' points.
Well, now that cuts the game to a 13-point deficit with 3 minutes to go in the quarter before halftime. And again, they've got to get a stop here. There's another steal. If they score, they're on the way to cutting this thing to under 10.
McGee for three, but he gets fouled in the act of shooting, so there'll be three throws here. Three, because he was in the act of shooting a three. So he gets the foul against three free throws, and the Sharks are calling a timeout. What do you think about that, Billy? Right time?
Well, I think it's a good timeout by Sheffield because they had two turnovers in a row, or a missed shot and a turnover. So at the end of the day, I think Pete Scantlebury said, look, guys, we had a big lead. We were up 20. Now they have a chance to cut it to 11.
Right here. Okay. We're just settling for outside shooters. L, if there's nobody on you, tap the gap at the top. On the weak side, you got to duck into the gap. The weak side is always open. On the other side is always open. All right, weak side is open. All right. From here, we got 20. All right, we got 20, 20 deep. Okay, watch the press.
Come on with the ball, fellas.
HL, you got it out of bounds.
Come on, fellas. Sharks on three. One, two, three.
Sharks, 21 times. 21 times.
Peter Scantlebury, tell his word. Here's Steve Swanson.
And remember, zone up on the weak side and roll to the shooters, okay? Offensively, let's have a one call. Swing it all the way around. Look for your curl option, okay? Dave, get up there quickly, okay? On the one, I want you on the block. Get up there quickly.
Here's Ron.
Okay, well, in that Scottish timeout, what he was saying is that the zone defense is working well, as Billy Mims alluded to. They're forcing Sheffield into outside shots, but he's saying when that takes place, Scotland must secure the basketball. There's no point in forcing Sheffield into a more difficult, lower percentage shot from the outside if they do all of that and then let them grab the rebound and go back up for an easier shot inside. So looking to secure the rebound after playing good defense.
Second of three free throws, drops to Terrence McGee. He'll go to double figures if he gets this one.
And you remember, he gets three free throws here because he was fouled in the act of shooting a three-pointer. If he'd have made make that shot, he gets 3 points. So fouling him to prevent him from making the shot, he gets 3 free throws.
So 10 points personal, and the gap is now 10 points between the Scottish Rocks and the Sheffield Sharks, and certainly those who've made that long journey down to Birmingham from Scotland. It's time to raise their voices a bit. Ryan King for three. They're not dropping for Sheffield, but he'll have a chance to go for the two. It says laid off nicely for H.L. Coleman. That doesn't drop either. And all of a sudden, maybe an important turning point in the game where all those shots were pretty much dropping, or the second possession was being got by Sheffield. At the moment, they're just having the wobbles a fraction, but maybe only a fraction. They've got that advantage. A very healthy one still it is for them, a 10-point advantage, and they've laid it up, and there's two more points, and that eases the pressure just a bit.
That was great ball movement by the Sheffield Sharks from one side of the Scottish zone defense to the other, inside, outside, back inside, and an easy score.
Another two at the other end. Michael Martin is involved in that move.
Well, we're back to a 10-point game, Bob. There's less than 2 minutes to go before the half. Scotland gets a couple of stops and gets this thing under 10. I think we've got a ball game.
Well, it's certainly looking much more encouraging and much closer than it was a few moments ago. Let's see whether that one from long range drops. It doesn't. Another turnover. Here's Perry with McKee looking for it near the basket. Doesn't drop. Second possession ball. McKee, 4-2.
Great effort there. Now, McKee got the gift and made the basket, but the basket was created from Jerry Williams' effort. Jerry Williams went down, and when Phil Perry missed the shot, Jerry Williams tipped it to McKee. McKee obviously took the present and scored.
From 18 points, it's down to 8, the lead for the Sheffield Sharks. Just about kept the ball in play, Ryan King, and that is an offensive foul. He knocked the opponent over in the act. The opponent already established his position, and Ryan King trying to go through where no place existed.
But that call is called that charge foul, and you're just not allowed to run over the defender. If the defender has established position, his spot on the court belongs to him. You cannot take the ball like a freight train and just run over the defender. Contact was created by Nate Ryan King, the Sheffield Sharks offensive player. The ball goes to Scotland.
Well, minute to go, under a minute in this quarter, and that, well, you might well say, why isn't that a charging foul from Philip Perry on Ian McKinney? McKinney's face seems to indicate to me that's exactly what he thinks.
McKinney said, wait a minute, on the other end, that, you know, we created contact, you call a charge. Phil Perry does create contact here to an extent, but he's going to the basket, and Ian McKinney, as you saw from that replay, ran in from the side. Might have created even more contact, but never established position.
Perry, all they need these to drop. Every single point now is crucial for them. They have to start accumulating the free throw shots.
Now, this quarter, Scotland have done a much better job of creating free throw opportunities, and now the Sheffield Sharks are in team foul. So anytime that Scotland are fouled in the last minute here, they will go to the free throw line.
Stewart. Oh, another good block in the center. This is much better from Scotland. Can they find Williams in the center? Will they need to? They're going to go with Perry instead. He's fouled on his way to the hoop, and this game is going through a transformation.
Now, Bob, the transformation has come about, though, defensively for the Scottish Rocks. The Sheffield Sharks are normally a good passing basketball team, but Scotland have gone to a full-court press after made free throws and scores, and this full-court press is causing, meaning they're taking their defense all the way up the floor, playing full-court defensive basketball, and it's causing the Sharks problems. They're making sloppy passes, turning it over, and until they miss free throws like this, Scotland are trying to capitalize on Sheffield's mistakes.
33 and a half seconds remaining. First half, second quarter, and two of them didn't drop. Oh, when it comes to the end of the games, those are your insurance points. They're your bonus points. If you take those, you stand a chance, especially when you work so hard to get your way back into the game. They're normally gimme points. It's amazing how many players. There's a foul committed by Perry on McKinney. He's got his own back there. It's amazing how many of those free throws from that, it's like penalties are missed.
Well, this is one of the old things. I like to say you get caught with your hand in the cookie jar. And here's Phil Perry as Ian McKinney dribbles by and reaching around from behind. And on that reach, slapping McKinney's arm, getting caught with his hand in the cookie jar, and a foul on Phil Perry.
18 seconds remaining, so Sheffield don't have to worry about the shot clock because they have 24 seconds. They can play it around as long as they don't turn it over. McKinney for three. In she goes. 2 3-pointers for Ian McKinney. He scored 2 baskets, both of them worth 3.
Boy, that is a dagger in the back of the Scottish Rocks. That they just missed 2 free throws on the other end and then give up a 3-pointer on this end.
Williams got a touch on the way. That will end play and end proceedings for the first 20 minutes. And, well, at one stage it looked like it was a complete runaway. But Scotland have hauled themselves back in. Quite how, maybe they don't know. The Sharks maybe just went down a tad. But the Sheffield Sharks lead the Scottish Rocks at halftime. Plenty of basketball left in this. 46-36.
Thanks, Chris. Well, we'll be going back to the second half of that. Let's take a quick look at the Premiership action today. Manchester United travel up to Newcastle, kickoff just after 4 o'clock. Chelsea are currently at Leicester, desperate for some Premiership points, and it looks like things are going their way. Chris Hollins is at the Walker Stadium. Chris.
Yes, thanks very much. Yes, this is always going to be a real test for Chelsea's Championship credentials. It's cold, it's windy, and Leicester are pumped up. But Claudio Ranieri's side, in truth, have had far too much quality to be troubled by the Foxes so far. McAuley and Lampard are controlling things in midfield. Jimmy Floyd, Hasselbank have scored both goals. The first, a tap-in after 11 minutes. The second from a wickedly deflected free kick. Leicester City desperately need an early goal to make this a competition. But so far, Chelsea look very comfortable indeed at 2-0.
And we'll be going back to find the final result of that later on, of course. Some rugby news for you. Brian O'Driscoll is definitely going to miss the Six Nations after picking up a hamstring injury. The first few matches anyway. The centre will be sidelined for up to 6 weeks after he limped off during Leinster's Heineken Cup defeat to Salem Friday night at Lansdowne Road. O'Driscoll had been tipped to replace the retired captain Keith Wood as the new captain. Well, bad news for Ireland there and, of course, Leinster. Now, when you're all sitting at home on New Year's Day nursing your hangovers, I was actually trying to find a leak in my bathroom, which is now destroyed. But Britain's Colin McRae was embarking on one of great sports, great adventures. The former World Rally Champion was released by Citroën at the end of last year and decided to take a year's sabbatical. But for Colin, that didn't mean a year relaxing with his feet up, I can tell you.
So here we are in the Nissan 2004 Dakar Challenger. This place is going to be my office for the next 18 days.
I think it's just a massive challenge, and it really captures the imagination of everyone. It covers such a vast distance of very, very spectacular scenery, and just a huge adventure.
As you can hear, sounds great. Almost anything that's put in its way.
For me personally, familiarisation with the sand and the dunes is an important thing. You don't want to go off there too quickly. You scan a huge area in front of you rather than just the road that you're normally used to looking just in front of me. So you've got to really have a good look at everything around you and try and pick your way through it, because you don't have to stay on a straight line. The approach has got to be right, sort of mentally, for this event. And I've won Safari twice before, and when I went to that event, I didn't think about winning it. The goal was to get through as quickly as possible without losing any time. And I think I'm going to have the same approach in Dakar.
A great piece of kit. And hopefully going to get me all the way from France to Dakar as quickly as possible, without too many incidents.
Well, is the Scot still smiling? You can find out. We'll show you some race action after the basketball, sometime after 4 o'clock. Now, we'll stay in Africa for a while, as there's something happening later this month that might just interest you.
The captain of Senegal has to score. Aliou Cissé.
Well, that all gets underway on January the 24th. You can follow all the action right through to the final on February the 14th here on BBC Two and BBC Three. I can't think of a better way to spend Valentine's Day, can you? Now, we're going to the basketball in a minute, where currently the Sheffield Sharks are beating the Scottish Rocks 46-36. But this is what's coming up later on. We're going to follow Colin McRae in the Dakar Rally. That's at 4:05. The Road to Athens at 4:15. And we'll have profiled Kim Collins, the world 100 metres champion. Alex Thompson and his ocean sailing speed record. Well, that's quite a story, I can tell you that. We'll be looking at that around 4:30. And then we're finishing today with Ski Sunday. Now, we go to the second half of the BBL Cup final. So it's back to Ron McIntosh. Ron.
The final coming up is the head-to-head between Ellie and Tahir. Both of them are Sharks fans, apparently.
So 36-46 it is at the end of the first 20 minutes play, and Sheffield Sharks did have an 18-point advantage at one time, but that all sort of frittered away, and Scotland came back into it with great force indeed. And Sheffield's scoring inside has been really where the key part of their game has been. We knew it would be. Here's the details of the first half. You can see the floor shooting there. Sheffield edging Billy Mims, Scotland out by about 9% there.
Yeah, Sheffield have shot the basketball a lot better, 51% to 42, but the three-point shooting, 35.7%, is excellent three-point shooting. Again, Scotland have struggled behind the arc, only 25%. Sheffield have hit five threes, Scotland only two. Second chance points, that means the offensive rebounds. You miss the first shot, you get a second again. That's the inside dominance, points off turnovers. That's a surprising stat, because actually Sheffield have turned the ball over more than Scotland, so points off turnovers. I'm a bit surprised that Sheffield have the lead of 14-8. Probably that has to do with the poor free throw shooting of the Scottish Rocks. And I think it's a key stat that Scotland are 6 of 11 at the free throw line, 5 misses in that second quarter at the free throw line, that could have made this a much closer game. While the Sheffield Sharks are perfect at the free throw line, 5 for 5.
Well, let's see why Sheffield got the big step on the Scottish Rocks early on. It's their inside game, really. It's what Peter Scantlebury said it would be, not outside so much.
This is just a great feed, and it was one-on-one basketball at the time. You know, we see the pass, and there's Phil Perry, Mark, and Angel Coleman. It's one-on-one at the basket, and Coleman scores. And here we take a look at Lenard Stewart driving. That's like one-on-three. He drives by, and again, here's Coleman driving to the basket. So it's been Coleman on one end, Stewart the next time. Coleman again driving, attacking the basket. Now, when they didn't attack the basket, Sheffield did make some valuable three-pointers. But there again, penetrate, give the ball to Phoenix. Here's great penetration from Yanders. Dish to Phoenix. He scores, he's fouled, and won.
And outside, pretty useful too.
Well, they missed
it.
They missed this one, but there's that second chance point. Nate Reinking misses the three, but the inside dominance, the second chance on the offensive rebound, and an easy score.
Now, Jerry Williams was the man who really took it off, didn't he? I mean, he scored the first, 9 or 11 points for them in the game. I mean, it was bang, bang, bang. Jerry Williams was in the groove and everybody else was at that stage.
Well, as you say, right now, Jerry Williams is their best player. He's their, what we call, the go-to guy. And here you see them going to Jerry Williams. He drives, he scores, he gets fouled, and had one opportunity. And again, although Jerry Williams opened the game with a three-pointer, he's much more effective at things like this. When he attacks the basket, puts it on the floor, drives, pulls up, scores. He's a very aggressive offensive player. And he knows the Sharks well. Remember, last season, he was a member of the Sheffield Sharks. Here's a steal from Phil Perry, and Jerry Williams again attacking the basket, finishing well.
So that's how it was in the first half for the Scottish Rocks. The Rocks are not back on court yet. They're in the dressing room. I'm sure plenty is having to be said by Coach Sweet Steve Swanson. Let's see what he's got to say.
Wow, you're exactly right. If David's here, okay, a Maryland call, okay, no matter where we're at here, all this is. Mike, you just do the same thing if you're in here, Ronnie. We're just going to step him down, set the back screen, come here. One call, we can do it quickly with him popping. Or we can dribble at him in this corner, okay?
got the screens here. Okay. It might involve Gary or Philip being in a spot you're not used to, okay, just popping out. But come off it, make your pass here, make.
I think it's very interesting to notice also that the Scottish Rocks have not been out on the court yet. They're coming back onto the court now, whereas the Sheffield Sharks were quite keen to keep those muscles loose, trying to keep the tempo up. They were back on the court. They were back into training mode straight away. Now, one man who's not involved in this match, sadly, from his point of view, is Ronnie Arinze. He would have been here, would have been a very important part of the Scottish Rocks. He is at the match. He's watching from the sidelines. He's with Ron McIntosh.
Indeed, joining me is Nicky Arinze, one of the co-captains of the Scottish Rocks team. Nicky, you're missing this game through injury, damaged ACL. What is the extent of the injury and what's the prognosis for the future?
It looks as though it's a torn ACL, which is a ligament that's inside the knee, kind of stabilizes the knee. Luckily, there's not been too much damage in my knee, so the recovery is, I'll probably have surgery in February and do rehab for five to six months. So after 5 to 6 months, I should be ready to play again.
So this season looks like it's over for you. Competitive athletes never make good spectators. How are you coping with missing what is the biggest game of your British basketball career today?
It's definitely disappointing. It's definitely disappointing that I'm missing this game. But I'm here with these guys. I'm here to support these guys, and I'm hoping that we win today. But you know, we're not playing as well as we could, but it's going to be a good game. It's going to be a tough second half.
Now, as well as the points that you bring, Steve Swanson talked about your leadership role out on the court. What kind of leadership have you been able to impart from your enforced role on the bench this afternoon?
I've really just been telling these guys, you know, that since I'm not out there in practice and in today's game, that other guys are going to step up. Other guys are going to have to step up, you know. When I'm not out there and I'm not putting up the points and the rebounds that I usually give to the team every night, that some of these other guys are going to have to pick up their games, and that's what I've been trying to get them to do. You know, some of these guys like McGee, Perret, and Cruz, they're going to have to step their games up.
Well, you were down by as many as 21. You closed it to 10 at halftime. How strong is the belief in the locker room that you can close it all the way, get over the hump, and win the cup this afternoon?
Oh, it's definitely strong. We didn't play well. In our eyes, we didn't play well in the first half. We didn't rebound. We normally get out on the break, and you know, we weren't doing that in the second half. But this time, we went into that zone. We got a couple of rebounds, and we were able to push the ball. So I think this second half is going to be key for us because we want to come out strong. The second half.
Well, Nicky, we wish you a speedy recovery and best of luck to your team in the second half.
Thanks.
46-36 then as we resume into the third quarter of this BBL Cup final. And, well, there was a huge chasm between them at one stage. That has been eaten into. Jerry Williams has been instrumental in that. They have the first possession of the third quarter to the Rocks. Here's Cruz, who hasn't scored yet and still hasn't scored. Forward player under Billy at the Leopards. What's wrong with David Cruz today?
Well, you heard Nicky Arinze, his halftime interview there with Ronald McIntosh, and following on from what Nicky Arinze said, he's not there. Other guys have to step up. And in the first 20 minutes of the game, David Cruz was 0-for-5 from the floor, 0-for-1 behind the three-point arc. They've got to get some scoring, some offensive additional effort from David Cruz, and without his scoring, it puts a lot more pressure on Jerry Williams.
Oh, Ryan King for three more. Ian McKinney started the threes in the first half, and Ryan King has now got his range together. That was accuracy personified, and he goes up to 7 points.
Now, you know, the Sheffield Sharks actually began the second quarter of the game on an 11-0 run. And then for the rest of the second quarter, the Scottish Rocks outscored them 22-11 to get back in the game. Now, once again, we've seen the Sharks open the third quarter with a 3-0 run on the first three-pointer. Jerry Williams, a 3-0 run, opening the quarter by the 3 points to none by the Sheffield Sharks, like they started the second quarter on an 11-0 run. Hopefully, free throws from Jerry Williams here will get Scotland back without being able to put a long, dry spell of not scoring.
Jerry Williams, who played for the Sheffield Sharks last season, so would dearly love to get one over on his old team here. First season with the Rocks. Spent some time in Florida as well a couple of years ago. It's amazing. I can understand why you'd swap the weather, though, wouldn't you? Florida for either Sheffield or Edinburgh, for that matter. Good hustling work by Philip Perry all the way through. Foul is called on Justin Phoenix.
Well, that was a close one there, because as he drives to the basket, he goes at Justin Phoenix, and then also Lenard Stewart comes over and steps in. Lenard Stewart just had his third personal foul called on him, and I think it's just Phoenix's third as well, or two on Phoenix.
Perry on the free throw line, though. need these to go. He had not a great end to the first half in terms of his free throw shooting. He's up to 5 now.
Well, the Sharks in a little bit of foul trouble now because they have 2 players on 3 personal fouls.
Well, these free throw attempts are mounting up now. 1 for 2 just ain't good enough.
Well, they were 6 of 11 in the first half, 1 for 2 there. Now they've gone to 7 of 13. You've got to make free throws to come down from major deficits. You know, there's an old saying, Bob, my coaches like to say, like myself, free throws win ball games. It's kind of like penalty kicks in football. You're supposed to make a penalty kick most of the time, and good basketball players should make free throws.
Rock still have possession, looking for the man outside. Cruz for his first points of the game, and there's 3 of them.
That's what David Cruz does best. He's got a really sweet stroke from the perimeter, and you know, they got to get some offensive input from him. That 3, hopefully, it will spark his offensive game the rest of the way.
Margin's 9, so we're almost back to where we were at halftime. In fact, that's a 1-point advantage as far as the Scottish Rock's concerned. There's Ranking. Stewart looked for the ball to drop into his direction, but instead Jerry Williams is doing the good defensive cover under the basket and sets the Rock's latest move forward up. McGee, Cruz, maybe that'll give him a few more thoughts about taking some 3 points from outside again. Perry, what great work by Perry, and it's got a deflection off Lennard Stewart. In fact, the last deflection, according to the referee, came off the Scottish Rocks.
I think Phil Perry dribbled that ball a little too much there. He got a bit of dribble-itis, you know, because as he was dribbling to the basket, right before he turned it over, Jerry Williams was open on the outside, but Phil didn't see him.
Coleman to Ryan King. 3 points maybe from Coleman. No, he just flips it inside very casually to Bernard Stewart. It's been a bit quiet of late, but gets fouled and gets 2. Wow, bit of a hook shot there from Bernard Stewart as he got fouled. He gets the 2 points. He gets 1 from the free throw line to come.
And here's, again, vintage Lennard Stewart. Attack the basket, get as close as possible to the goal, and score inside. And again, he draws contact. He'll be at the free throw line. Now remember, Sheffield have not missed a free throw in this game, but this is one of their weaker free throw shooters on the line.
Well, he scored the only 2 he's had to take so far in the game. Let's see whether they're going to get 3 and 4. No.
Bob, I'm sorry, but I knew he could not have a perfect game at the free
throw
line.
Billy, commentator's mouth. You've done it again. Perry. You know this man well by now, Jerry Williams. Cruz, outside of Perry, Martin, nowhere to go. Good cover by the Sheffield Sharks. They've got to go underneath the basket. They want to score, and they're not going to get it. They're not going to get the foul either they thought they might get. Meanwhile, at the other end, they're bobbing them in from everywhere, including H.L. Coleman for another 3. 17 points he's got now.
That was a great series to show Sheffield's dominance. Inside, they get a great block shot from Lennard Stewart. Fast break and a kick and a finish with a 3-pointer from H.L. Coleman. Dominance on both ends of the floor.
Williams for 2 at the other end here in the Haribo Cup Final 2004 at the NIA in Birmingham. Yanders, looking for Stewart. Yanders again, is he going to drive? Yes, he is, all the way. Oh, what a basket by Rob Yanders. He was not going to be stopped. There was nobody going to stop him in his way. It was like a runaway train, and what an excellent shot.
And you know, for people watching the game today for the first time, Robert Yanders is a very small basketball player. A lot of people think you have to be 7 feet tall to be a basketball player. He's only 5'8".
Just picking up on that point from Billy, Robert Yanders, weighing in about 11 and a half stone, 5'11", so he's about the size of a middleweight boxer. Him and Terence McGee, very similar in size. They were from the same city, they were teammates in college, very much on the opposite side today, but both very rapid, skillful players, and how that's going to be a big factor in determining the outcome of this game. They want to set the tempo and get other teammates involved. The point guard is known as a coach on the floor. They've got a lot of responsibility, and we'll see who gets the better of that matchup this afternoon.
H.L. Coleman, 17 points. Jerry Williams, 17 points. They're matching each other on the scoreboard, though. Still a 13-point advantage for the Sheffield Sharks, who are on the ball now. Ryan King looks for three, still looking for three. Is it three? Not this time. Off right, and the follow-up nearly finding its way in through Justin Phoenix. But a fast break maybe now from the Rocks. Williams again. There is more than one man on the court. There are four others, but he's doing everything.
Well, again, with Nicky Arinze's injury and the absence from the club, he's a captain, he's their leading scorer, and he's trying to take the team on his back. And he's being put under that pressure by some of the other guys, as Nicky said, not stepping up.
Coleman. Yanders for three. Not this time. But the rebound comes back to Justin Phoenix. Maybe Yanders will have another go. He's got that fire in the belly at the moment, as if he can do virtually anything.
And the Scottish Rocks have changed again. They're back to man-to-man defense. They're getting a good steal from Phil Perry.
Here's a breakaway for Perry. Should put this away. Oh, no, you can't allow that to happen. That just is a dagger in the heart. That kind of thing just cannot happen. Too casual, far too casual.
Well, you make the play and come up with a great steal. You should get an easy basket, but you've got to be able to finish.
Leonard Stewart. Nate Ryan King, they're working around nicely. 3 seconds on the shot clock, and then a foul committed by the Scottish Rocks, so it's immaterial about the shot clock now.
Stepping across, blocking foul, Terence McGee.
Timeout has been called. Coach, 13-point advantage. The Sharks leading the Rocks 57-44, so the gap is not that much bigger than halftime. Let's hear from the coaches that have plenty to say, I'm sure, at this stage. I'm sure that both Steve Swanson for the Scottish Rocks will have a few words to say, and Peter Scantlebury as well. Let's see whether we can get a chance to hear what they do have to say.
Remember, we're in key spots here, okay? You're going to look to step out, especially if it's shooters Jerry and David.
One, two, three. We're going to have better movement if we got wheel. All right, instead of standing and watching, we're going to have better movement. We get you subs in and out, in and out. Get you some blows so you can keep going, all right? Let's go.
Rothbury.
57-44 then. The Sharks with a 13-point advantage. 4:34 remaining in the third quarter, and well, the gap is not much bigger. It's only 3 points more than it was at halftime, so unlike the first quarter where the Sharks ran away with it, they've been pegged back this time, Billy.
Yeah, they haven't put it, you know, Sheffield, you know, throughout the game have looked the stronger side, but so far they haven't been able to deal that knockout blow. You know, that Lennox Lewis knockout punch from the Sharks just hasn't happened yet. Scotland are hanging around, and if they hang around too close, too long, could be dangerous.
McKinney for three. Not this time. He's already scored two. Williams. We know him by now. There's the other Williams. Junior Williams and Jerry Williams interacting. Philip Perry. Oh, interception. Away goes Ashley Cole. Wait for the spectacular.
Basketball. That's what the young fans in the stands come to see. Exciting Sheffield Sharks supporters. H.L. Coleman with the Dipsy Doo slam dunk.
19 points. Yanders. McKinney. He and fellow Sheffield lad Richard Windle looking to spin move to the basket. Oh, ostentatious. I have to say, there used to be a player who played for Sheffield a few years ago called Jason Crump. He used to do that rather nicely there. A little hang time and get the ball running off at the palm of his hand, but Richard Windle just not quite up to it this time. Offensive foul's been called against the Sharks.
Initiation of the contact, again, I guess must have been felt that Richard Windle, Bam Bam, initiated the contact instead of Scotland. Now Sheffield back here going to a zone defense themselves. Peter Scantlebury changing defenses, trying to throw Scotland off here.
Williams to Williams, and 2 points. Jerry Williams, 19.
That was good ball movement there against the zone by the Scottish Rocks. Took advantage of the opportunity for an easy score.
Here's Robbie Anders again. Oh, fantastic move. He won't result in a basket this time. There's a few little party tricks here. Here's Perry now. He's got two on one, and Williams will put this away. Very calmly, very casually, end of the fingers. And a timeout's been called by Sheffield. 59-48, 2:54 remaining in this third quarter. Remember, one more quarter to come. And at the moment, Sheffield can't pull away from Scotland. It was 10 at half time. It's 11 now. Let's see what the coaches have to say.
I know, but you got to settle down. I know, you got to settle down, and then they'll move off you. All right, settle down. Okay? Back here now, we're going to go back five. Go back to man. All right, you're Williams. Okay, back to man.
Come on, fellas, let's go.
Let's go, baby.
Let's re-establish the defense.
Pick it up.
Three, one, two, three, defense.
Okay, set your man up. Okay, Phil, Jerry, back screen, get the ball over here. We got that option, we got a driving option. Mike, you're gonna rotate back to the middle for a second, and then whichever side we have it, we got driving options.
Iowa.
Well, the Scottish Rock saying in that timeout there, they're just working on their systems. On the offensive end, they're looking to pick the holes in the Sheffield defense. So lots of ball movement, lots of men moving around, getting into open spots, and they feel that's going to get them good looks at the basket. On the defensive end, looking for energy and looking for communication to stop Sheffield getting easy looks at the basket.
Leonard Stewart. All the way, no. Was it is attempt by Michael Martin, his first game with the Scottish Rocks, and he trained with them once this week, and they go for the long bomb this time. It doesn't work, they have another go, they're working so hard, and ultimately it's two more points for Michael Martin, 6 points in total, and the gap is just nine again.
Big contribution on both ends of the floor. You get a block shot defensively from Michael Martin, keying the fast break, and he finished with the 2 points on the other end.
Ian McKinney, three-point specialist, looking for that option. The bounce pass was on, but instead he just lobbed it up to Leonard Stewart. Richard Wendell for 3 points. And bam, bam, does it again. 3 points for the big lads from Sheffield. And just calms the nerves a fraction.
Once again, that's late in this quarter when Scotland had got it back under 10 to a nine-point deficit. You don't expect Richard Wendell to be standing out there knocking down threes, a dagger in the Rocks' efforts.
Now, Leonard Stewart has just committed another foul, and I think that may be his fourth.
Sheffield certainly in a bit of foul trouble right now because that's four fouls on Leonard Stewart. You've got Justin Phoenix on three personal fouls, and Nate Reinking also on three personal fouls. Now, Scotland haven't taken advantage of that because they haven't made free throws tonight. But the Sharks are in foul trouble, and in the fourth quarter, that might become a factor.
Williams, again to Williams. Very involved, and they throw the ball away. That's the kind of thing that really hurts a coach. When you've had your timeout, you can see everything working really well, and that final pass is just thrown away casually like that.
Well, a sloppy pass. You're trying to create something because David Cruz saw one of his teammates cutting to the basket. Looked inside, but just threw it a bit quick for his teammate to receive.
H.L. Coleman, top scorer for the Sharks with 19. Nate Reinking lost it, gets it back again. Leonard Stewart under the hoop for H.L. Coleman. No, no, and no again, but third time, there's Leonard Stewart to put it away for two more. They worked so hard. That was like third possession there, not even second choice.
You're right, that wasn't a second chance point, that was maybe a third or fourth chance point, but again, size and athleticism inside for Sheffield.
Well, Philip Perry's done some good things in this game. He's also done some rather lackluster and careless stuff, and again, they've thrown away the opportunity, Scotland, of a couple more points there in good position. Coleman, Stewart, double-teamed for a moment, double-teamed again. Here comes Nate Reinking, up, down, and pulled away by Richard Wendell, so that'll be a turnover, and ball will return to the Scottish Rocks. 23 seconds, last possession of the quarter.
And again, it's a big possession because if Scotland can end the quarter with a field goal here, cutting it to maybe 11 or 12, they go off the court with a little momentum in their favor.
Jerry Williams.
Watch the clock. That clock actually equals what's on the shot clock. They're going from outside this time, falling back and straight into the hands of Wendell. They won't have chance for the shot. Ranking has a go. It wouldn't have counted anyway. He's just smashed the board on top of the scoreboard, the little time clock there. But apart from that, no real damage done. And the Sheffield Sharks have a 14-point advantage going into the final quarter of this BBL Cup. The Haribo Cup Final of 2004, 64-50, and 10 minutes remaining.
Who's going to win the game?
Well, Peter Scantlebury has done everything as a player, he is as a coach.
Offensively, inside out is on. Don't just stand still. When he had the ball right there going and you just stood to start with. All right, then inside out is on. All right, they put that press on again, attack it. They got the zone. We work it. We got to have movement. All right, we got to have movement. Okay, let's go, fellas. 10 minutes to run, baby. Hold on, one second. You know they're gonna try and force stuff, all right? Nate and Ian, don't let them, you gotta climb that middle and that penetration. If he penetrates on Ian, you're standing way over. You gotta clamp it, make him kick it out, all right?
Shots on three, one, two, three, shots.
It's worth talking about Peter Scantlebury, MBE, 40 years of age now, 3 championships, 2 at Sheffield, 1 at Thames Valley, trophy winner 3 times, cup winner 3 times, 604 league appearances he made, 9,811 points all told, and 131 England caps. He's pretty much the Gary Lineker, Bobby Moore, call him what you will in footballing terms, of the basketball world. And 5 years of play with Sheffield, made his debut for England in 1986, and he finished playing last year.
Here we get a good look at the crowd today. It's been a great crowd here. The atmosphere's been fantastic at the NIA today. But talking about Peter Scantlebury, Bob, I remember Pete when he had hair.
When was that, man?
So Pete actually came to America to play college basketball and went to university. And I picked Pete up when he got off the plane in Charlotte, North Carolina. And back in those days, he had Jerry curls.
60, whoops, I'll ask you about that later. 64-50, Sheffield Sharks lead the Scottish Rocks.
And Bernard Stewart, 12.
Right, well, we'll start that all over again in just a moment. Just we'll hear what the Scottish Rocks timeout, or rather the end of the third quarter talk from Steve Swanton was like. Ron McIntosh was listening in.
Well, Steve Swanton looking for his team to employ some high-energy tactics now on the defensive end in an effort to force a turnover. That's so they can regain the ball back and then get into an offensive set. He's looking for them to trap, so anytime the ball goes to either of the four corners in the Sheffield half of the court, expect to see two Scottish players there trying to force the Sheffield player to give it up. On the offensive end, they may be going to the long range shots now. They may be going to the three-pointers in an effort to close this gap in a hurry. But energy on the defensive end was the main message that Steve Swanton sent to his Scottish team in that timeout.
Ian McKinney outside for the Sheffield Sharks. Nate Ryan King. The big three-point shooters, both on the court together. First in the league last year and third in the league last year. Both on the court together. McKinney was first, Ranking was third. Williams has not been off the court. I think Williams has logged every minute of this game so far. McKee, look to find the big man in the corner, Cruz. Williams is going to go forward and try and get as close as he can for the two-pointer. And he is really on form today, 23 points.
Well, we talked about the first two games, that when they beat Sheffield in the league, when they lost to Sheffield in the league, in the first two meetings this year, he was held to 10 and 11 points. Today, he's scoring 23 because he knows he's got to today. There's no Nicky Arinze to pick him up. It's a big game. He's got to carry his side.
Good strength under the hoop, but it didn't turn out in terms of points for H.L. Coleman. It's going to be a jump ball. They can't decide, or have they given the possession? They have given the possession to the Sheffield Sharks in the end there.
Bob, that goes back to the arrow, the alternating possessions, because the last possession of the arrow, the start of the fourth quarter, the ball went to the Sheffield Sharks. So in the next jump ball situation, it went to Scotland. Now, the arrow's in the favor of the Sheffield Sharks. So if we have another jump ball situation, a tie-up, where both players have the ball or the referees are uncertain who the ball belongs to, the arrow says it will go to Sheffield.
We have to get used to that. It's another new change for this year. There are a few new innovations. That's one of them. And of course, the fact that we don't tip off to start the second and fourth quarters as well. A couple of fresh legs come in for the Sheffield Sharks as the Scottish Rocks have a few words. Just to say they have the top scorer in Jerry Williams at the moment, 23, as Ian McKinney and H.L. Coleman come out for the time being. Abe Ranking has stayed there. Rob Yanders is back out on the court. Ryan King always looking for the three-point opportunity wherever possible. Phoenix hasn't scored for a while in the game. It's a bit of a knock as well, and then the fact of smack in the face he got there.
Now you see Bunyan's the lad there.
First court time, sorry, Billy Bunyan's first court time for the three-pointer.
I was just about to say, the lad we saw there, the first time he touches the ball is a three-pointer. Keith Bunyan is the Scottish version of Ian McKinney. He is the best three-point shooter in Scotland, one of the best I've ever seen.
Bam, bam, for two. So the Sharks lead 66-55. McGee, 4-2, he goes to 14. Ranking for three, another one goes up and another one goes in. Ranking takes his total into double figures, he's got 10. And Sheffield have a 12-point advantage and Steve's on the move again.
That's where Sheffield can really hurt you. You see, as soon as they get a big three-pointer, Scotland from Keith Bunyan, Sheffield come right back and knock down another three-pointer. So they're strong inside, but they got a great outside attack as well.
Williams actually missed out this time. Rare event. It does happen occasionally. Yanders, Ryan King. And they're just eating up as much of the clock as they can. Time is on their side. 6:45, Stewart. Ryan King for three, a long 3-2. Oh, that's out of play, out of bounds. Phoenix threw it up to Wendell. Wendell doesn't agree, Phoenix doesn't agree. But Dale Aitchison is the man that makes that call.
Well, you can see there, what happened there was, I think, well before the end of the play, Phoenix's foot was on the out of bounds while he had possession of the ball.
Williams, Bunyan, it's Cruz. Robbie Anders, Richard Wendell. Knight Ranking goes the long way around. Stewart, 11 seconds on the shot clock. They have to start thinking about formulating a shot here. Ranking outside. Inside, 4 seconds shot clock, 3 seconds, Yanders. Well, they didn't work that ball particularly well. It was a bit of a desperate shot in the end. Time was running out. The other end, it's not tipped in by Martin. Did everything he could to get hold of it. McGee put the original layup up. Wendell will try and hold off Jerry Williams. Should be too difficult. It's about a foot in height difference between them. Yanders. Coast to coast, right at one side to the other. McKee, there's Peter Scantlebury looking on. Bunyan for three! Two shots, two threes for Keith Bunyan. Why didn't they bring him in earlier?
Well, I said he's the Ian McKinney of the Scottish Rocks. The first two times he's really touched the ball with an opportunity. When this guy gets a good look at the basket, he's deadly from three-point range.
9 points the advantage again for the Sheffield Sharks. That went off the leg of Williams. They'll reset the shot clock again to 24. And a timeout has been called by the Scottish Rocks. Keith Bunyan with 6 points. Jerry Williams, 23. McGee with 14. All those players have to step up in the remaining 4:54 for the Scottish Rocks to win it. And Steve Swanson's going to have to say some well-chosen words here.
Okay. Phil, you got David for a second.
Okay. All right.
We're still in four out or overload. Whichever you guys feel like. Nah, four out or overload. Look for the teams here. They might go man. Okay. Mike, if they go man, okay, and you're inside, keep looking for the ball to get swung around, set a back screen, and then come back to it. Start working back. Okay. We'll have a flex cutter, and then you roll back to it. Okay. Stay after it down there. we are attacking the basket very well, okay? I think there's some opportunities when we're here, and we have decision-making area. You might have some shooters sitting over here, okay? A couple times we've gotten right here, look for your shooters. Keep attacking the basket, but if the defense comes, keep moving the ball and look for those things, okay?
Right here, baby.
Hey, we're gonna go to a 32 here. 32, keep on the top.
So the end of those very important timeouts. Ron McIntosh will give his views on what he heard.
Well, Peter Scantlebury very calm during that timeout. He's saying he's liking what he's seeing on the offensive end. He said there to keep attacking inside, press home that advantage that they have. And he finished by saying, this is our game. Absolutely no doubt in the mind of the Sheffield Sharks coach that this is their game. They're going to be the BBL Cup champions.
Yanders in and out. So now, could the advantage be 6 or 7? Bunyan's there again. He's the go-to guy every time here, surely. Martin Vatoo drops. 8 points personal.
Well, Ronald McIntosh talking about Peter Scantlebury's confidence, but I tell you, they have not delivered the knockout blow. It's 4 minutes to go. It's a 7-point game. They should be far ahead of this game without Arenze, but Scotland have just kept battling.
Yanders, again, trying to go through like a knife through butter. Back outside, they're not dropping at the moment, but they're getting the rebounds, which is key. It's very important that they get second phase possession. Stewart rolls with the finger, and they've now scored for the first time in 3 minutes.
You know, it's a dangerous thing. I keep talking about Sheffield not giving this knockout blow. And I think that's what Peter was trying to say to them over there by saying, it's our game. Trying to wake them up a little bit and say, put this thing away. Because coaches know that the longer you let the underdog hang around in late stages, a couple things go wrong, you can let them slip back in and maybe pull off the upset.
72. 62, 15 points personal for Lynard Stewart. Martin Williams for three. Yes! 26 points personal. This is a one-man crusade for Jerry Williams to turn this game on its head, and he's doing so well.
And Bob, we still have only a 7-point basketball game, so with a lot of time. 3.5 minutes in basketball is a long time.
Ryan King, yes! Three from him. They're trading threes again. Ryan King goes to 13, and the advantage trips back up to 10, and the Sharks just have a bit of daylight, but as we saw, it can be taken up very, very quickly. Foul committed by Yanders, who I think is not in foul trouble. He's okay. In comes Cruz, Bunyan goes off. I'm not sure that's a great move, really, but Bunyan's always there to come back in.
Well, you've only got 3 minutes left, and you've got to try and get back in this thing. Make these two free throws here, and it becomes an 8-point game. But the presence of Keith Bunyan, I think what Steve Swanson's done, Bob, is go with what we have, a defensive-offensive substitution. He knows now that after these two free throws, Scotland are going to be on defense, and Keith Bunyan is not as good a defensive player as he is on the offensive end. So I think what you'll see is if Sheffield go to the free throw line, you might see him substitute Bunyan back in to have his 3-point presence on the offensive end.
Okay, let's add up the free throws they missed in this game and put them onto the score. Because this is where it gets crucial. 9 points is the difference, and they've missed, what, 8 free throws in this game? Pretty close to that. They missed 7 free throws in this game, so the gap would be 2 points if those had gone down. Now you can see just how important, how crucial, ultimately, they can turn to be. Great finger roll by Lynard Stewart. He did it for us earlier. He's done it for us once again. And Lynard Stewart is putting on a few party pieces today. That'll be Scottish Rocks ball. Sheffield Sharks ball, rather. End line possession for them.
Yeah, I think Jerry Williams panicked a little bit and forced that shot a bit quicker. It was a tough shot under a lot of pressure. Not a very good choice, not good shot selection there. Forced that one. It's still 2.5 minutes to go in the game, down 11.
Well, there's plenty of time yet for this game to change. Stewart on the turn, gets fouled in the act of shooting. He'll get two free throws to come. The foul is committed by David Cruz, who's not had a great game from his point of view. Let's go to Ron, who's got some more news for us from the sidelines.
Well, during that Sheffield Sharks timeout, as I said, Peter Scantlebury requesting that the Sharks continue to press home the advantage that they have inside. Since that timeout, they've gone three times inside to Leonard Stewart. He scored two baskets, and here we see him making two attempts at the foul line. So carrying out Coach Scantlebury's instructions to a T, and it's paying dividends for them.
Oh, both of those missed.
You know, I tell you, it helps a lot in carrying out your coach's game plan. When you don't do it, you've got guys that can knock down 10 three-pointers.
Oh, Williams, what a collision there. I hope he's okay because he slipped. I think it was more of a slip than a foul. But as he went there, he's going to see him back on his feet again.
Yeah, no doubt he slipped there on the way to the basket, lost his footing. He's okay.
McGee, Martin, reverse. Oh, no. And again, if anything, I think they've been a bit too casual at times today for those nail-on two-pointers that should go away, trying to be a bit too clever.
Well, Phil Perry and Michael Martin have played hard all day, but they just haven't finished well around the basket. By finishing, I mean you're close enough, you're getting the shot, but you're not putting the ball in the hole.
Timeout's been called by the Scottish Rocks. This is the last one they can call. 11 points is the advantage. 77-66. 1:49 remaining. This is the last hurrah for the man who was successful with Brighton last year, Steve Swanson.
Down here, we're manning up, okay? Get yourself in a position where you can go for a steal out of the out of bounds, okay? Whoever's guarding you out of bounds, man, step away and try to get in the passing lane, okay? Down here, we're going to have to do that a lot more, okay? When we score, we're pressing up on our guys, okay? If your man's down court, you're gonna be between your man and the ball in a situation where you're in the passing lane, okay? We gotta really work at that. All right, down here, I want open. I want David and Mike here, okay? Terrence, Jerry, Phillip, okay? We're driving, kicking, okay? We got David in the corner. Mike, you can look at your options. If they're driving here, you can probably step in, okay? Keep looking, we need points now. We don't have to have threes. This whole area is open for you, okay? But if the defense closes up, look for somebody to pass to, okay? If you're the guys getting the pass, you have to get in the passing lane, all right? Let's go. Things have to happen quick here now, okay? Rocks, 1, 2, 3, rocks.
109 seconds remain in the game. They've seen success time and time again. Ron McIntosh, your thoughts?
Well, what Peter Scantlebury said is to expect a press and expect the Scottish team to foul them because they have fouls to give, so expect to be hit hard. In that case, he's telling his team, be strong with the basketball and don't stop attacking. He finished by saying, this is it, this is the time, meaning referring to what Billy said, this is the time Sharks have got to put this game away and deliver that knockout blow.
So Sheffield have all the cards, but they don't have the ball at the moment because Terrence McGee has it. It's got to be quick, got to be very quick, and he gets fouled on the way to the basket, so the foul is on Yanders.
Bob, you sounded like Steve Swanson, the Scottish Rocks coach there, because in his timeout, he said, guys, okay, we're okay, but things have got to happen quick now. They've got to get quick scores, quick stops.
Here's Williams, two men onto him straight away, and he's coughed it up, and there's Yanders, who's pretty deadly. He's just going to hold things up. Time is very much on their side. Double team, the foul committed by McGee.
That was a smart play there. Fans probably saying, why did Robert Yanders not go to the basket? They're 11 points up. They don't need points to win the game now. They need the clock to run out. We see that, and of course, Scotland, and Steve Swanson was saying things have to happen quick, but good things have to happen quick. I don't think he made quick turnovers, and that was a tough turnover there from Jerry Williams.
Minute 21. It's with Phoenix. Yeah, and as everybody seems to be slipping over on this court all of a sudden, which is a little bit of a worry because there's another game to come on this court. The BBL Championship match is being played later in the day. Maybe just a little bit of moisture out there. 11 points the difference. a minute and 12 remaining. You'll see every nerve and twitch of Steve Swanson as the last few seconds unravel, as Sheffield just keep possession of the ball. That's what they have to do, get fouled. Foul is David Cruz. Well, last year was successful under Nick Nurse at Brighton, but this time round doesn't look like he's going to put it off.
Well, I think today again for the Scottish Rocks fans, you know, Steve Swanson's done a great job in his rookie season getting them to this point. The team's done a great job getting to this point, but today might also be for their benefit what might have happened. You know, what might have happened? What would this game have been like if Nicky Arinze had played? I mean, it's only an 11-point deficit now with a minute to go, and Nicky Arinze is certainly worth more than 11 points to the Scottish Rocks.
Another turnover, another steal, another attempt for the Sheffield Sharks to eat the clock down. They don't need to score now for the 12-point advantage. They're home and hosed. Yanders, 45 seconds and counting. He gets fouled again by Cruz, who's committed two back-to-back. He had to stop the clock because they need the possession.
They also need not only stop the clock, they need basketball. So they need Sheffield to go to the line and hopefully miss free throws. And they've got to come down quickly. And watch them now. Scotland will probably look to fire up quick three-point attempts for this last 44 seconds.
Yeah, it is. Adds to his tally. Seven. Individual. H.L. Coleman leads their scorers with 20. Yanders goes to eight. Sheffield have this game in the palm of their hands. 14 points advantage. McGee, foul committed on Martin, who looks like his first game with the Scottish Rocks will be a losing one.
Steve Swanson, though, one of the BBL's best young head coaches. This is his rookie season as a head coach. Like you said, he did a great job last year as an assistant to Nick Nurse. I'm sure Steve Swanson will be back in this environment in a game like this again.
Lynard Stewart getting a great reception from the Sheffield fans. He acknowledges them, they acknowledge him. 18 points he's put away for them in the game. Very important contribution. Martin goes to nine. Back off the rim, back into the heart of the basket. He goes to double figures, and there's a foul committed. Richard Windle showing his footballing skills. Big smile all over the face of the big man. And it'll be Sheffield possession. So Lynard Stewart has been given the accolade of the most valuable player. His all-round contribution and some nice frilly skills along the way as well. We've seen a few finger rolls, we've seen a few little dipsy-doos, some really nice stuff during the game.
17 points from Lynard Stewart, 8 rebounds, a couple of block shots. Both ends of the floor, he emphasized Coach Pete Scantlebury's philosophy of inside dominance of the game.
This will be 22 for H.L. Coleman if he puts it away, and he does. And the Sharks are pretty much finishing as they started. 14-point advantage, last 30 seconds. A little bit of climbing, a little bit of hanging on the rim there to make absolutely certain from Michael Martin. Phoenix, this will be the last but one possession anyway, although the foul is committed, so that means and once again, Rob Yanders will go to the free throw line. And there's some rather dejected looking faces out there, not surprisingly, because Scottish Rocks have played their part in this final. A final looked like it was only going one way at one time.
I think their fans have got to be extremely pleased with how their team has performed today. Steve Swanson, I know he is. He's disappointed not to win, but they were huge underdogs today. Nicky Arinze averages over 20 points a game. He's the, you know, one of the team's leading scorers, a co-captain of the team, and he's also the team's leading rebounder. And he's not there today, not for 1 second of this game. What would this game have been like? We don't know, but boy, it would have been a great one to see.
The ball's going to finish with the Sheffield Sharks. It looks like it anyway. Yanders will just take his time, bit of showboating, playing around, try and get maybe everybody involved in the game. It's all been played at dead slow and stop pace. Nate Ranking's going to go for a three. Surely he's just going to hold on to the ball. The last 2 seconds, that's exactly what he does do. And the Sheffield Sharks, as they almost seem to do every basket, basketball season have a trophy to take back to Ponds Forge. 83-70, the Sharks have beaten the Rocks. Peter Scanterbury, who's done everything there is possible to do virtually in basketball, has done it as a coach. His first cup final, his first victory, and I think everybody in the game is thoroughly delighted for him.
You got it, like you said, Peter Scanterbury's done everything involved in the game. He's been an ambassador for the game of basketball, you know, not only here in England, but throughout the world where he's traveled with the England national team. Congratulations to Peter Scanterbury and the Sheffield Sharks.
Let's go to Ron McIntosh. He's got one of the key people involved in today's excitement.
Indeed, joining us is the head coach of the Sheffield Sharks, Peter Scanterbury. Pete, congratulations. Your first victory as a coach. How does it, first major trophy victory as a coach, how does it feel?
Oh, it was great. You know, the Rocks pushed us hard all the way. We thought we had a little gap and they came back and they kept pressing us hard. So the guys had to put in a lot of effort and I'm very pleased.
You win everything in a player as a game, everything there is to win. How does this, your first win as a coach, compare to all the success you had as a player?
I don't know, it hasn't really sunk in. But the guys have done worked hard for the first part of the year, and I'm glad we got something to show for it.
We said it at the top of the program, this remarkable consistency that Sheffield are able to deliver. How important is the continuity you're able to bring in carrying on that success?
Oh, it's a big part, especially early on in the year. When guys are trying to find their feet, we already know what we can do. Later on in the year, we try to improve on it, but for the start of the year, it's a big thing.
Now, just a word on the Scottish Rocks. So we're missing one of their key players today, Nicky Arinze. As soon as he was out, you were saying you're going to go inside and exploit that weakness that they now have. But do you feel any sympathy for them, the fact that we're missing their star player?
Oh, yeah. I mean, obviously, you know, it's hard luck for them that he wasn't able to play, but they still played us hard. It wasn't going to be an easy game by any stretch of the imagination, and I thought we had a good half-forward win today.
Was there any doubt in your mind that you were going to lose this game? You sounded very confident throughout during all the timeouts, very calm and collected.
Well, you know, you got to believe in everything. There's always a doubt you may lose, but we believe and we won.
Congratulations, Pete.
Thank you.
Peter Scanterbury with Ron McIntosh, and now the moment that all those who travelled down the M1 and the M42 have been waiting for, the presentation of the first PBL Cup, the Haribo Cup for 2004, and Sheffield know this feeling well, but I'm sure they like it just as much every time round. Richard Windle, the lucky talisman, is in the team again. Ian McKinney was cup-tied for one of the victories that Sheffield have had in recent years, but nonetheless, it'll be a great moment for them and the whole of the Sheffield basketball fraternity, and there are lots of them when they step forward. First of all, commiserations to the losers. There's Ronnie Gordon, who acknowledges the Scottish Rocks fans who've been really noisy and very involved in the whole game. Joshua Tackey takes his medal. Jerry Williams will be the next man up, who was absolutely outstanding. Had the Rocks won, he would have been MVP by a country mile. But because they lost, even though he got 26 points, he misses out. Keith Bunyan got 2 3-pointers. Junior Williams was involved in a lot of the play, but didn't actually register any points. One of the Scottish players, Ross Campbell, 11. Terence McGee, 15 points. He contributed a great deal. Michael Martin, also his first game, 12 points from him. David Cruz, however, will not feel quite so chuffed with his performance today. Just that 1 3-pointer when he thought he might come alive. Philip Perry with 5, and they all gave everything they could. Nicky Arinze will get the medal as well. And Steve Swanson comes forward. Well, he got the winning feeling last year with the Brighton Bears. This time round, he has to accept second place with the Scottish Rocks, but they did very well to get here. And I wonder what Thames Valley are feeling, who maybe should have been there if they threw away the semi-final, and it could so easily have been the Thames Valley Tigers against the Sheffield Sharks. But that's what they've been playing for. That's what they've been working so hard for over 40 minutes. The celebrations can start now, as they know it's a job well done. The Sheffield Sharks are the BBL champions of this particular cup final in 2004, and Ian McKinney, 2 3-pointers at the very crucial time. Big smile all over his face. He's been with the Sheffield Sharks since 1995. The captain raises the new trophy to the fans, fans to the photographers. They will enjoy their Sunday night in Sheffield. He'll enjoy once again being part of a winning Sheffield Sharks team. They really had pretty much all the bases covered here today. Justin Phoenix comes forward to pick his medal. Some of the youngsters who didn't get much of a look in today will also be there. Rob Yanders as well. He contributed 9 points. Nate Reinking also coming forward to collect his medal. 13 points. 3 points from all over. In fact, to a man, they were pretty good from one right through to 10. Sheffield Sharks then are the champions of 2004. They're top of the championship as well at the moment, so they'll be looking for more than just one honour this year. But they've come through, but in the end, a big victory, 83-70 against the Scottish.